Is there anybody else that we miss? Let's all stand up and greet each other. Happy Sabbath. Please be seated. And of course, we understand that Nanay Siling will be returning to the Philippines. She's been with us for many months. How many months, Nanay? 9 months. So we wish you the best of luck, a safe trip going back. And come back again. Come back again. So another thing that I want to share with you is there is an ongoing evangelistic meeting in Westminster Church. Tonight is the last night. The speaker is Dr. Vic Arriola and his wife. He is a very powerful speaker, both of them, husband and wife. So tonight at 7 will be the last night. So if you have time, please go there. May God bless us all.
Good morning, and I see that everyone is happy, manifesting the true essence of the Sabbath, and that's a good sign. So happy Sabbath, everyone. Sing with us in praise to our God. Our first song is found in hymnal 279, Only Trust Him.
For our next song, let's open our hymn on hymn 528, A Shelter in the Time of Storm.
Thank you. What do we need in times like this? We shall know that. We'll sing hymn number 593.
Loving Father, Lord, you know that sometimes it's difficult to make our minds stand still and rest. And I pray now that as we enter this sacred moment, that we will rest in you, that we will be available to hear what your Holy Spirit wants to say to us today. And I just pray that you will speak to every heart. May we all be encouraged, instructed, inspired, because we've been in your presence. We thank you and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's time for our garden of prayer. Those who have a special request, special thanksgivings, answered prayers, I invite you to come forward and Brother Edmund will lead us in our garden of prayer.
Thank you. Our most gracious and kind Heavenly Father, this moment, Lord, we come to you with praises and adoration in our hearts. We praise you, Lord, for being a God, a consistent God, and in you there's no shadow of turning. You are the same God, a loving God, and understanding God, yesterday, today, and forever. We come to you, Lord, with an open heart today, with a broken spirit, and seeking your forgiveness of our sins. We believe in your promise that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Lord, we give everything to you today. We confess our sins. May you forgive us of all our shortcomings and renew a right spirit within us. Create a clean heart in us, O Lord. And in a special way, we bring to you the congregation, each one who is in front of you, who worships you in spirit and in truth. We pray that you will be with them and touch their hearts, Lord. Touch each one's heart today, that we may feel your presence and that we may learn of you through the message. We pray in a special way for our speaker, Brother Joey De Leon. May you touch him and hide him behind the cross of Jesus Christ, that you may be glorified and that your name will be praised. We pray that you will fill him with the Holy Spirit and empower him that he will speak according to your will and he will strengthen the faith of each one. We pray, loving Father, that may the Holy Spirit will always guide us and give us wisdom, that everything we do will be for your glory and in accordance with your will. We pray for our guests and visitors today, our friends who are maybe their first time or second time that they are attending the church. We pray that you will bless them. May you guide them into all truth through your Holy Spirit. We pray for the community around this church that you may touch them and prepare their hearts, Lord, for the message that the church will bring to them. May it be, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will help us, that peace and love will prevail as we study and hear your message today. Thank you so much, and we praise you for all the blessings that you have showered upon each one of us during the past week. And thank you, Lord, for the life and health that you have given to each one, that we are able to worship you today in spirit and in truth. Thank you for hearing our prayer, all these things we ask, in the loving name of Jesus. Amen.
May I call on our deacons to please come forward. Our offering this week is for the Adventist World Radio, or AWR for short. Change was in the wind in 1989 when the Cold War ended. The Berlin Wall came down and Romania was liberated. As Romania's communist leader, Nicolae Ceaușescu, and his wife fled for their lives, they were captured, tried, and executed. Ilie Radu and his wife, Lija, felt free for the first times in their lives. Ilie began to search for answers to the question that had been burning in his heart about God and about what happened when you die. After a few years while studying the Bible, they discovered that Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River and not sprinkled. Eli immediately requested that his new church family baptize him. He was informed that he had been sprinkled as a baby, and that was good enough. Feeling devastated, Eli began again to search for truth. Then 4 years ago, Eli was working as a switcher for the railroad. One day he noticed that a fellow worker had a radio up on his cell phone, and when they had some downtime waiting for the train, he would listen to the radio on his phone. That gave Eli the idea to do the same, so he began listening to a Christian station while at work. The station he liked most was the very popular radio Bosia Esperante, an affiliate of Adventist World Radio. Would you like to know the rest of the story? This is how our reading ended today. And I try to follow up what happened. Eli continued his Bible study. He happened to have a Bible for the first time in his life. And at first, he used to attend to a Pentecostal church. And as he continued studying the Bible, he found out about the Sabbath truth. He asked the minister what happened. And they said, just forget about the Sabbath. Stay in this church. But he is trying to look for a Sabbath worshiping church, and he found one in his town. And there he said immediately, I want to be baptized. And the pastor was a little bit hesitant to baptize him. But when the pastor asked him questions, he knows everything. So he was baptized together with his wife and one of his child. They have two children, but the other one is not yet ripe for baptism. A year later, the child who was not baptized together with the family was also baptized. Let's pray. Our dear loving Father in heaven, thank you for the story of Eli and Lija, who found the truth through the Adventist World Radio. I pray that you will continue supporting AWR. Bless them and their vision, and may they continue to point you forth so that they will be able to spread the good news, the everlasting gospel, to the unreached people of the world. Like the example of this family who found the truth through the airwaves, may you bless others who are searching for truth. May you continue to bless the work of AWR, the staff that work hard, so that they will be a blessing to the world. Lord, as you are coming soon, may you bless all the efforts of your people here on earth. I pray for the opportunity you have given to us to return the tithe that belongs to you and the offerings to support your work here on earth. May you bless each and every one of us. We thank you for the opportunity. And may God bless all the funds that will be collected and all the works that will be exerted so that we others will know you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our deacons will come to collect our tithes and offering. So it's our children's turn for our children's story. So children, please come forward and Sean will lead us in our children's story.
Hello. morning, kids. So I'll be talking about how Jesus can save us from our sins. Okay, so these potatoes represent us, human beings.
Hey, doll.
See, look how dirty it is. But pass it along. And God promises to remove the hardness sin brings to our lives, and here's our and this is our memory verse. Take away my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Psalm 51:7. And here's after. Cleaner than this one, right? There's no more dirt. Dirty one. Ew. This is before with our sins, and this is after. God washes our sins. Okay, let's pray. Dear Jesus, as you rub the dirty potato, rub away my habits that harden me to the needs of others. Leave me pure, clean, and glowing. Amen.
I'd like to invite you to open your Bible to Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. And follow me as I read from the King James Version, Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold the one to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and Mammon.
Our speaker for today is Brother Joey De Leon. The name sounds familiar, but he is not associated with Tito, Vic, and Joey. That's one thing for sure. But the main thing is, his message is also very popular because we found him to be a God-fearing man, a loving husband, and he will be in the church whenever there is a need for him. So we praise God that Sister Feli and him happen to be in our church. So before you listen to him, we will have a special number from Brother Melchor and company.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Before we sing, I'd like to read this passage. It says, Jesus, our Lord, will carry you through the most difficult circumstances that life can throw at you if you will trust in him. God will carry you. It's the title of our song.
There is no problem to be God cannot solve it. There is no mountain to tow God cannot move it.
There is no storm too dark God cannot come.
Was beautiful. about that. That was so beautiful, Brother Milcher and Sister Modesta. He will carry you. Good morning, church family. Welcome to our visitors. We are thankful that you're here. And it's sunshine outside. Now, I don't know if I'm the only one here that has a tendency to worry. Is there any worrier here today? If you don't have anything to worry about, I could probably help you something to worry about. There's a lot of things that if we want to, we can worry about. We can worry about your salvation. We can worry about the salvation of others you love. We could worry about our health. We could worry about money. We could worry about life. We could worry about death. We could worry just the basic of day to day. No limits of the things we can worry. And in spite of all the things that concern us, do you know that we are commanded not to worry in the Bible? Let's see, where's my... Jesus, in his Sermon on the Mount, got right into it. He said in chapter 6 of Matthew verse 34, "Therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things." He commanded us not to worry. Worry wears the life forces. Worry robs us of our joy. Someone says, worry brings tomorrow's difficulties into today. God doesn't give you grace for tomorrow's difficulties. He only gives you grace for today. Worry don't take the sorrow out of tomorrow. It only brings the tomorrow's sorrow into today and less prepare you to deal with tomorrow's sorrow. So it's debilitating. I'd like you to go ahead and join me in the same passage in our scripture reading for today. Turn to Matthew 6, chapter 24, chapter 6, verse 24, and here Jesus said, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." I'm reading in the New King James Version. Some other version might say something different. The word there, mammon, actually, the meaning is abundance. It's an abundance of things or abundance of riches. A translation can be the abundance of stuff. You cannot serve God and the abundance of stuff. We tend to worry our stuff, all kinds of stuff. Stuff can be things, stuff can be other stuff. And then Jesus go on, in case you have any doubts, and he specify Matthew 6:25. "Don't worry about your life. What will you eat? What you will drink? Nor your body. What will you put on? Is not your life more than your body, more than food, and body more than clothing?" Just think of it. Some people worry all through their lives about staying alive. So when their life is over, you ask them, "What did you do?" "I worry about staying alive and now it's over. Instead of leaving, you see where there's a problem with that. Now, we have lots of commandments in the Bible. We got the Ten Commandments, and every now and then some of the commandments say, thou shall not, and thou shalt. You actually have a commandment here from Jesus, thou shall not worry. You might say, well, you're God, you know everything, but I don't know what will happen. But the question is, do you trust your life to someone who does know? God say, trust me, live by faith. Don't worry, it destroys your witness. For one thing, Christians are supposed to be people of faith. So I'll tell you this story about two friends. He's talking to his buddy, and he said, my house is in foreclosure, and I lost my job, and extended plan is canceled, kids drop out in school, and my credit card is maxed out, but I don't worry. That's what he said. I actually hire some professional worrier to worry for me. And the friend said, oh, it's amazing. So how much it cost you? Oh, $50,000 a year. $50,000 a year? Where in the world you can get $50,000? Oh, that's his job. I don't need to worry about that. So, is it good that somebody will worry for us? That's good, right? Do we have somebody? The Bible say, we can cast our cares upon him. Worry is not a part of God's plan with us. Maybe we should start and go to a definition. To worry, it means to feel anxious, concerned about something that may happen or will happen. To torment oneself, to suffer from disturbing thoughts or anxieties, to fret, to be stressed, to be troubled, to agonize, to be bothered, fear, unease, sleeplessness. The word worry actually comes from the old English word worgen, and it means to choke or strangle. Have you ever seen a person that is choked by his fears? An example is in the game of basketball. There is your free throw shot, everything is dependent on you, and you know, for the team to win, and all the worries come out, and the anxiety and pressure, he choke. Have you ever seen that? So, but Jesus talks about how worry will choke you. Apparently, he has a parable for it. Luke 8:14, some of the good seed fell among the thorns are those who have heard, go out, and they are choked with cares, riches, pleasures in life, and bring no fruit to maturity. And I wonder how many in their Christian experience is choked by worry. If we could just learn the lessons of faith, you will be in peace, you will be a happier and a better witness for the Lord. Now, there's another story. I think probably everybody knows this. This is in Luke chapter 10. And the question is, will you worry or will you worship? Go to Luke 10:38. I have to be very careful sharing this message to you because I want to make clear that we need Martha too. Especially when there is a potluck. So Luke 10 verse 38 to 42. Now it happened that they went to a certain village. I think that was Bethany. A certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. We know that they were friends. She had a sister named Mary, also had a brother named Lazarus, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving. Have you ever, that the word distracted there? Have you ever been worried to distraction? When you go, like when you have visitors at home, you go from one place to other, I have to go to the kitchen, I went to the room, I forgot this, and then, oh, this one is boiling, and it's so stressful, and the doorbell rings. So that was Martha. Martha is like, and then on the other hand, Mary is just sitting there listening to the word. And Martha is glaring at Mary every time she walks, passes by, and then look her in the eye. And finally, Martha said, Jesus is being an accessory for the irresponsible behavior of Mary. I have lots of things to do. Finally, he stops, and he taps her feet, and with his arm folded, he said, Lord, can you help me? Don't you care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Look, she's just sitting there. Tell her to get up and help me. Jesus said to her, Martha, Martha. Can you picture Jesus shaking his head? Martha, Martha. You are worried and troubled about many things. Any Marthas here? Come on. Am I wasting my time? How many do you worry? I think the question is, what do you worry about? I don't know if this is going to bother you, but or maybe think less of me as this church member. But I don't worry about your troubles as much as I worry about my trouble. It's not that I don't care about you. You're my brothers and sisters, of course. I care for you. But your troubles usually don't keep me up at night. Will you forgive me? I think I will, because my troubles don't keep you up. So yesterday I was briefly taking a nap. I lay down and start thinking of my sermon. I'm not even halfway, and suddenly my heart is pounding, and it's like a mini panic attack. I say, oh man, it's not even halfway. How can I get it done? But then I remember 20 years living here in Canada. I have always had multiple jobs. I still do. I said, I'm still alive. And it seems like those things that happened over the last 20 years somehow get done. And the ones that didn't get done didn't kill me. I'm probably all right. The things that you worry about sometimes, you look back and you say, God, work it out. And I wasted all the joy I could have had during the time and peace and good witness worrying about the things I don't need to worry. God took care of it. And Jesus said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things. One thing is needed. Mary has chosen the good part. What did Mary choose? She said the word and worshiped Jesus. So, you want to worship or you want to worry? I remember back in the Philippines, I was in high school. There was a terrible fire in Manila. More than 30 people perished. And one of those people is my high school classmate. The exact location is in Santa Ana. I don't know if you know that. In the area where houses and population are very dense. And to be able to go inside the neighborhood, you have to go to the alley of maize, like narrow maize, like alley. And the authorities determined that the cause of fire is due to what they call an overloaded circuit. there are too many wires plugged in to a breaker that can handle so many amps. So it heated up, sparked and shorted and caught on fire. And because of the narrow alleys there, people are trapped and died from smoke inhalation. And a lot of people die and the damage caused upon overloaded circuits. When you spend all your time worrying about tomorrow and the week after and the month after, and you just pile one on top of the other, you overload your truck. You blow up your tires, you overload your circuits, and it fries. And God didn't design us to be this way. He said in the Sermon on the Mount about worry, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. That's the King James Version. In the New King James Version, is sufficient for the day it is own trouble. Meaning that God gives you enough grace to deal the problems of today. There are problems in life. And the Bible is pretty clear about that. God uses us to test us and to teach us. You can read in the book of Acts 14:22, Paul said, strengthening the souls of the disciple, exhorting them to continue in faith, and he said, we must through many tribulations enter the kingdom of God. Tribulation, the word tribulation there is related to the word trouble. It's through trouble we enter the kingdom. There's going to be trouble, there's going to be problem, but God doesn't want you to worry about this problem. He wants us to learn to trust through the troubles. You know, many stories in the Bible about the children of Israel, they are in a point of, there is hopeless. They're in the border of the Red Sea, a mountain on both sides, ocean in front. And the army of angry Egyptians charging onto them, they were not armed, and they started to cry. And what will we do? And you know God, what God said? Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. You know, God allowed those troubles to come that they might develop trust. Deuteronomy 33:25, your sandals shall be iron. Iron, that's very uncomfortable. But I'll explain it. And bronze, as your days, so shall your strength be. Meaning, they don't wear out. You know, in the 40 years they're in the wilderness, their shoes didn't wear out. Their clothes didn't wear out. And he said, as your days, so shall your strength be. God will not give you a Superman strength today that you don't really need until tomorrow. When the challenge comes, he gives you the strength. Let me ask you, do you have enough faith? If we get tortured for our faith, where will you deny Jesus? Will you deny Jesus in the face of torture? If you ask me that question, my answer will be, not today, I don't. But I hope when that day comes, I will. Because as your days, so shall your strength be. You don't say, give me this month my monthly bread. You say, give me today my daily bread. Now, God tells you not to worry. If God tells you not to worry, it doesn't mean you're not going to plan. Should we plan? But a lot of things we worry about, you don't even have to deal with it. Somebody did a study about the average person, what they worry. They say 40% of what people worry never happens. 30% of what people worry has already happened. And you cannot do anything about it. Have you ever spent time worrying about regrets? Where you come to a difficult conversation and you're thinking what you should have said? I've done that. Or you made bad decision and you just keep on rehashing it. You can change that. It's in the past.
So 12% of worry about what others say about them. You don't need to worry that because you cannot do much about it. And 10% worry deals with your health. And of course, if you worry about your health is going to be worse. And that means 8% that is worth consideration. You know, most of the things that we worry is really a big waste of time. Now, when the Bible say, do not worry about your life, Jesus said, do not worry about your life. It's a command. And it doesn't mean don't ever plan. Don't ever think. God is not asking you to go through life with no care, being irresponsible. No. God does want you to think, and there are scriptures for that. Proverbs 21:5, the plans of the diligent lead to plenty, but those of everyone who is hasty leads to poverty. So you should plan. Proverbs 11:14, where there is no counsel, people fall, but in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. There needs to be planning in life. God is practical that way. There's a difference between being aware of the problem and worrying about the problem. Stressing, being anxious, losing sleep, you need to know how to commit your troubles to the Lord. And now you might be wondering, is worrying a sin? Well, it can be. You know, whenever Jesus say, thou shall not worry, and you worry. Well, first of all, Romans 14:23, whatever is not from faith is sin. So if we are spending a lot of time worrying about things, it means you don't trust that there is a God that can help you. Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please him. But he who comes to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those who search for him diligently. So worry contradicts your witness. Worry is an indication that we think God cannot look after us. There's a lot of people who worry about what they don't have, but there's a lot of people that worry about what they do have. We know there are lots of people who worry about what they don't have enough, but you know there are a lot of people that worry because they have too much. I think it was Ben Franklin that says, abundance destroys more people than poverty. So you can worry both ways. You know, everybody knows the price of housing here in Vancouver is very expensive, right? In the Lower Mainland, even the Fraser Valley. Because land is expensive. So this developer, condo developers, they try to be creative and they do everything that they can save space with their development. So when you go to the new condo development, the bedroom is so small. You go to the presentation center and when I talk to them, why do you build so small? Oh, because, you know, because of the environment. We produce too much carbon and we need to reduce our carbon footprint. And we need to start living small. That's their argument. But part of the reason for that is, I don't know if you know the statistics, in the last 45 years from 1974, the average North American house has gone up 1,000 square feet. 1,000 square feet. Just look at the newly built house in Surrey. There's like humongous, so big. And yet during the same 45 years, the number of people in the house has gone down from 3.5 people to 2.5 people. So we got fewer people in bigger houses than ever. And those house is also full of stuff. Is that right? How many do you drive in your neighborhood, and you know your friends or your neighbor has a two-car garage, and both cars are parked outside? My car is inside my garage, but I have cars parked outside. You can ask my wife. So Jesus said, man's life does not consist in the abundance of things that he possesses. There's a law of life. You will fill whatever space you have. Move into a bigger house. Wait for a few years, see what happens. You will fill whatever space you have. And if you live in North America, you might rent extra space to store your stuff. And then you have to worry about your stuff. And you can't go for a mission trip for Jesus because who's going to take care of your stuff? Am I right? You can become a prisoner to your stuff. And you spend your weekends, you could be visiting your neighbors and friends, doing Bible study, but instead you're busy cleaning and maintaining your stuff. And mowing your stuff. Got really quiet all of a sudden. Okay. Okay, 1 Timothy 6:6. Now, godliness with contentment is a great gain. If we can just be content and satisfied with a little bit, and everything else is a plus. 1 Timothy 6:7 and 8. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing with this, we shall be content. 1 Timothy 6:9. For those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and snare, into many foolish lusts, which drown man in destruction and perdition. Notice the word drown there. 1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Money is not evil, but the love of it is. For which some have strayed from faith in greediness and pierce themselves through with many sorrows. In spite of all other problems that come with the abundance, there are many sorrows pierce them. It's just being worried. People think happiness is going to come from more. More will make you valuable. It's not true. More things will make you more popular. Again, it's not true. We'll just make people envy you. More things will make you more secure. More things will bring you more contentment. Usually, if you are not content of what you have, more will not bring you more contentment because you will discover things that you don't have. And or your neighbor have something that you don't have. 2 Corinthians 9:8, God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that always having all sufficiency and all things. Do you notice how many alls there are? God is able to give you what you need to do his work. God will not send you out of this world to do his work and not supply you with the things that you need. God knows the things that you need. Now, having said that, about not worrying, is there time that we should be worried? The answer is yes. Everything that God said about his promise and not having to worry, he is saying to those who have accepted him. If you have not accepted him, you should worry. You really got something to worry about. Hebrews 10:26 to 27, for if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of truth, there is no longer remains a sacrifice for sin, but a certain fearful expectation, isn't that worry? Of judgment and fiery indignation which will devour the adversaries. If you are turning to God, your back on God, and you are refusing to follow God, then I hope you don't have peace. Why would you want someone to be comfortable in the road to destruction? So there is a time to worry. The Bible said in Isaiah 48:22, There is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. Revelation 16:11, speaking of the lost. They blasphemed the God of heaven because their pains and their sores did not repent of their deeds. They have something to worry about. But for believers, we live by faith. Remember the story about Peter walking on the water and surrounded by a storm. As long as he keep on eyes on Jesus, he can do the impossible. You can have peace in the midst of storm. Jesus was sleeping, and the disciple woke him up. And Jesus said, why are you afraid? Where is your faith? You shouldn't be worried about this. And now Peter, walking on the water, and he's looking at in the storm, and he takes his eyes off Jesus, and he started to sink. When he stopped looking at Jesus, and he started looking at the waves and the winds, he started to worry. If you look at the problem and you don't look at God, you'll probably lose faith. The reason why David killed Goliath was he doesn't look at how tall Goliath was. He looked at how big God was. And, you know, every day, we should start our day opening the windows of heaven and say, Lord, I'm yours today. My problem is your problem because I'm your child and he will take care of you. So Peter took his eyes off Jesus, and Jesus said, why do you doubt? Why did you look at the waves and the wind? And the Bible tells us, as in Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and the sin. Sometimes we worry about our sins, right? And which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus. In other version, it says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. The reason why we worry, because we take our eyes off Jesus, and then we look at the winds and the waves, and we look at the problem. Again, it doesn't mean that you go on your life without care and being responsible, but make sure your faith is hanging on Christ. So what's the answer for worry? Philippians 4:6, be anxious for nothing. The word anxious there means anxiety. It means worry. Don't be worried about how much. Paul said, don't be worried about anything. It doesn't mean you don't think about anything. You understand the difference? But don't be anxious. Don't be stressed. Don't let it choke you. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication. So there's one answer. With thanksgiving, be grateful of what you have. Let your requests be known to God, and the peace which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. So here are some things you can do about worry. Pray. Sing. Join the choir. They are looking for singers. Have you tried to sing a happy song when you're worried? Either you get mad at the song or you'll change your attitude. But actually, if you start singing and praising God, the song can actually bring you out of it. So you got to sing. Three, believe the promises of God. Believe that He's with you. Believe that He's in control. No matter what the problem is, God has the answer. You know the promise in Romans 8:28? All things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. Count your blessing. Exercise. Run. Join the sun run. And you know, you might be actually writing all your troubles and give it to God. Say, Lord, you are my professional warrior. I'm giving my worries to you. Jeremiah 29:11 claimed the promises of God. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, say the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you hope, to give you a future and hope. 1 Peter 5:6-7, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all of your care. What percentage of our care? 25%? Oh Lord, I worry you cannot do that, so I need to worry some of it. Casting all of your cares to him. Why? Because he cares for you. Now that we have the answer, so what's the solution? Jesus gives us the solution. In Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Our priority should be to do the work of his kingdom, to share the gospel, his kingdom in us, his righteousness, his kingdom around us. If we make it the priority to build up his kingdom, God says, all these things, what are these things? The things that people worry about, you know? For you, it may not be food, it might not be clothing, it might not be drink, but whatever it is, cast all your cares upon him. All these things shall be added unto you. Amen? I don't know about what you think. If anyone had to worry about, it would have been Jesus. Can you imagine knowing from 12 years old that you will be the sacrifice of the world? That's so stressful. And even though it was revealed to him at 30 when he began his ministry, can you imagine going to 3.5 years that knowing that you will be tortured, going to be punished for the sins of the world, going to be placed in the hand of the devil, and you will be experiencing death? How would you feel knowing that? Every day, one day closer to the cross. Another day, one day closer to the cross. You notice Jesus never bothered him until that day in the garden. It was a tremendous load. Jesus was not worried. So we are his followers, right? Do Christians try to imitate Christ? One reason people are attracted to Jesus was his peace. He wants us to give that kind of peace to us. Now, when I talk about these things, I think my most important message is I'm talking to myself because I worry too. And to all the Marthas in this church, I salute you, because if you want something to be done, give it to them. But those same gifts are also a problem when things get out of control. They really worry. If they got it, everything puts in place and all ready, they feel great. I got it covered. But if things starts to move and the unexpected happen, they are in the verge of a meltdown. And then they want others to worry with them. And that's why they go to Jesus, Mary, make Mary help me. We all really have those two choices. Are we going to worry or are going to be worshiped? Are we going to live by faith or just live for the glory of God, trusting that even you don't see him, Would it make you feel better if God just whispered in your ears, "I know what your troubles. Don't worry, I got it covered." Would it make you feel better? What do you want? God is doing it today. He said it in His Word. It's not me. It's the Word of God. So Jesus said, don't worry. He wants you to have peace. And you watch one by one as He's taking care of you throughout your life. That's why you're here, the church, safe and sound. He will take care of the problems. Pray for wisdom, pray for grace, pray for energy. Whatever you need to pray, pray for the practical answer and then leave it to God. He doesn't want you to go through life choked. Amen? I remember a movie about the businessman got on the airplane one time, and then one of the last people that they brought inside was a young 7 or 8 year old boy, unfortunately was traveling with 2 divorced parents. And his first time he had to do this, maybe the first time he ever flown. And when the flight attendant buckled him next to the businessman could tell the young boy was very nervous. And as the plane was taxiing and the engine began to roar, he could tell, and before takeoff, the businessman saw the little boy hand were in the armrest and his knuckles were white. So, and the man looked down to the boy and said, "This is my favorite part. Isn't it fun?" And the little boy saw the man smiling and saw so much excitement. The little boy thought, "Oh yeah, this is fun." And he immediately relaxed. If you're traveling with your Heavenly Father and He is not worried, why you worry? He's in control. You don't have control. God will take care of you. Jesus said, "Come unto me, cast your cares upon me. My burden is light. My burden is easy. My load is light." Jesus cares for you. And that, I believe, our closing song, number 99 in your hymnal. Let's stand together as we sing, "God Will Take Care of You," and then we'll pray. Well, I don't know if you need this message, but I needed this message. I am not a big worrier, but I worry a little bit. And God doesn't want us to stress. I just suspect I'm not the only one. Worry about things that never happens. Worry about things that already happen. Worry about our health, which make us less healthy. And Jesus said, do not worry. Do you know that he said that 12 times? Do not worry, do not worry. I want to ask you again, do we have any worrier here? Does it help to know Jesus is telling you, you can trust him? Not to worry, as someone would say, I got it, I got it. The Lord wants us to live lives of faith and trust in him. Let us cast our cares upon him. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for the promises in your word. Help us to remember them. Lord, we are tempted to stress and to worry over things behind and things ahead, or having too little or too much. I pray that you will just give us your mind, your peace, and your wisdom. Help us to know that we've seen the captain and he's smiling. And the Lord, if we do have cause to worry because we have not surrendered our life to you, I pray that every person here will make that decision right now to find that peace that passes all understanding, because our lives are hidden with God in Christ through faith. Lord, I pray that we cannot only experience this for our own good, but for our witness for you, that people will see that we are a people that have peace, because we know that there is a God that can bring us through the storms of life. Also, Lord, we pray that you will bless each person with their individual concern. We want to pray that you even bless the food that is being prepared right now and our fellowship together, and just pour out your spirit on this church family, that we can let our light shine in this community. We thank you and ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless everybody. Thank you.
Visited. Thank you very much, Brother Joey, for that very powerful message. We should not worry, because most of the time it does not happen. And God don't want us to worry. But before we go downstairs, I got a message here from the Secretary of the Board, Sister Mindy. This is the first reading, the transfer of membership of Eden Ularte from Vancouver Filipino Seventh-day Adventist Church to Burnaby Philcon Seventh-day Adventist Church, and the transfer of Jobu Miharis membership from Vancouver Filipino Seventh-day Adventist Church to Oak Ridge Seventh-day Adventist Church. So this is the first reading, and we will do the second reading on Saturday, and then we will approve it. May God bless us all. Everybody are invited to our fellowship lunch downstairs. Thanks for all the Martha who have prepared those things. It's really hard to have no Martha in the church. I hope the Martha are helping. It seems that it's only the Martha. Thank you very much, and may God bless us all. So our guests and seniors, please go down first. Those with children, and the rest could follow. Thank you.